The goal of photogrammetry is to create 3D models using photos. In this video, I'm going to be using 3D Flow's 3DF Zephyr software to create a model of an entire mountain. So there's going to be some advanced techniques involved. If you haven't yet, go check out 3D Flow's YouTube channel. The link is in the description below. I'm Scott Nebuker, and this is Redshirt Media. So this video isn't intended to cover the basics. It's more towards the advanced stuff, but I think it's good to review how Zephyr makes a model, namely through Samantha, Stasia, and Sasha. Let's take a look at those right now.
Right, so a quick review. Samantha. Samantha is the workhorse. It determines the position and orientation of each photo or camera in relation to the subject. This is called structure from motion and gives us the sparse point cloud. And then there's Stasia. Stasia takes the sparse point cloud and builds on it in a process called multi-stereo view. Basically, it takes the sparse point cloud and uses multiple cameras to view each point to determine the point's accuracy and creates the dense point cloud. Then there's Sasha. Once a dense point cloud has been created and verified, Sasha then creates a mesh. A mesh is a big game of connect the dots that turns simple points in space into polygonal surfaces. The final step results in the textured mesh, which gives us a color balanced version of that mesh before.
So with that under our belt, we need to do something first. We gotta get Samantha some photos. And the way that we do that is to hire a good pilot. And I'll show you more about him in a minute, but first we gotta fly.
What's this thing for?
So this is a photogrammetric model of a mountain. A while back I was told that it's really not possible to do the very small, and it's not possible to do the very big. And so what I did was, while we were on a flight, I asked you to go around Mount Tipinogos.
Right.
And so we went around just one time, and I was able to create that model. So basically what we're doing today is a duplication of that for use and training and to basically show people the methodology of creating these kind of models that are very big.
Gotcha.
Gotcha. I love Barry. He's a good guy. I love how he flies that plane with one hand. So we're going to go ahead and start the new project. Now, all the images that I have are indeed masked. So we go ahead and advance to that, add the files. I've got 200 exactly. That's just to round things up and make it nice and neat. And I'm going to go ahead and just make sure that everything is set right, make sure the masking's right, and make sure that the calibration is correct. Now, pay attention here. I'm going to switch it to aerial and then keep it on default, but I'm going to change one setting there, and that's the circular setting for the ordering. And that's because I did go around the mountain completely.
As we come up to the top of Mount Tipinogos, we're going to do two times around the mountain. Normally what you want to do when you're creating a 3D model like, well, not like this, but like anything you're doing, is to do at least three shots or three times around. You want to go from the top to the middle and right towards the bottom of the subject. With this, it's a little bit different because it's a friggin' mountain. So we're going to go from the top so we can see the top of the mountain. And then we're going to try to go probably about the middle, right? Would that be about right?
Yeah.
Around the middle of the mountain. Mainly because of time. Because it's costing a lot of fuel and all that stuff. But yeah, so we're going to go from about the top and then about the middle.
I mentioned that we go around the mountain twice. However, I'm only using images from the one orbit, the first one from the highest position. As I move the model up like this to get more of a top-down view, you'll see there's a lot of points that don't quite fit into things. And that's basically noise. So I'm going to be spinning the model around, up, down, all around to get rid of all those points. And instead of having you go through and watch that with me, I'm going to have you watch my pilot do what he does. And he's quite the badass at what he does. He flies air shows all over the United States. Here he is. Yeah, that's my pilot. His name is Barry Hancock. So I've got everything all cleaned up the best that I can, or really the best that I want. Like I said, dealing with a mountain like this with a huge model, it's really hard to get rid of all of the noise. So you have to go back later and fix things that may not have gone quite so well. There's one thing that I did not do, and that's save the project. And you always, always, always should save it, and I should have saved it at the very, very beginning. So once that's saved, I'm going to go ahead and create the dense point cloud. I'm going to keep this as simple as possible by keeping it aerial and keeping it default, just because I want this to be as easy as it can be.
It takes a little bit of time for that sparse point cloud to become a dense point cloud. Now, if you notice with that whole ordeal with the sparse point cloud, and I was going through picking apart every single little thing so much that I had to speed it up by 600% and show you something cool, that's because I just get so particular about eliminating those points from the sparse cloud, because those are actually act as sort of seeds for the dense point cloud. The processes involved there are Samantha and Stasia, Samantha being the main one, Stasia being the one that works off of what Samantha did, and they both work interchangeably.
Of the two, Samantha really is the big sister. Stasia will refer back to what Samantha did. Looking at the dense point cloud here that I created, you'll see again that there's more noise that needs to be eliminated. And there's one very good tool for that, and that is the confidence tool available in Aerial and Pro. So here's the confidence tool. It basically shows what Zephyr is sure about and what it's not sure about. If I slide the slider to the right, you'll see things become more purple. That shows how confident Zephyr is in where those points belong. I'm going to put the slider right where I feel comfortable with, and I'm going to get rid of the points below that threshold. Now you see here, I've got something that's kind of goofy. I made a mistake and actually made that fine tuning on the wrong cloud, which is fine because I actually made a copy. There's nothing wrong with that. Now it's on to making the mesh. I'm going to get everything centered here and take a look at it, make sure everything looks good. Everything does look good, then get started on this mesh. I'm going to click on that and make sure that you're using the right cloud for this. Once again, we're using Aerial and Default, and there's a reason I'm using sharp features here, and I'll explain that to you.
It's hard for me to describe when to use smooth and when to use sharp when talking about the detail settings, especially with landscapes. So I'll demonstrate with Captain America. This Captain America has really smooth surfaces. He's got a smooth head, and yeah, he's basically smooth. So I would call this one smooth on the details, right? But I don't have that with this mountain. What I have is more like this Captain America, if I can make that stand still, more like this Captain America, where things are kind of craggy, more like sharp edges. Everything's not quite as smooth as this Captain America. So smooth for this guy if you were a landscape, and sharp for this guy if it was a landscape. So Yeah, by Captain America's. Yeah.
The mesh came back pretty good, and I made some intentional holes there because I want to show you how to fill some of these holes. It's going to show that zero hole, that beginning hole, as the entire bottom, and I don't want to fill that whole thing. So I'm going to go one up from that zero and actually fill in just that top few holes. You'll see that Zephyr has filled that hole very well. I'm just going to take a look at the nice grandeur of what I've created so far. This is just the initial mesh, and it looks really good. You can tell that it's a mountain, and that's fantastic. Next thing, I'll apply another filter, and that filter is the photo consistency based optimization. Now, there's something very important about this right here. The processing time for this is directly related to the amount of cameras that you use. I'm going to down that from 4 to 3. Now, because I got such a good result off that mesh, I'm going to up the resolution of it to 50%. And instead of just applying the filter, I'm going to clone it and apply it. That way I have a backup copy if I need to refer to it later on.
That initial mesh came back looking really good. And doing that photo consistency based mesh optimization actually is sort of a security blanket for me. I don't have to do it, but I do it anyways, just because. Now I'm going to skip forward now into the actual textured mesh, just because there's not very many steps in between. And we'll show you what that looks like.
So this is what it looks like. This is the textured mesh. It looks kind of dark right now. Just turn the lights on or off on it. And then just take a look at this thing. It's pretty fantastic considering the fact that I used mostly default settings throughout the entire thing. And if you look at the sides, you see that there's those 200 cameras or 200 photos that I took while flying around the mountain. And that's actually kind of cool because you could see our flight path around the mountain as we went. And you can see there's a lot of details in the foreground as well. So because I'm proud of this, because I like it, because it's so fantastic, I'm going to upload it to Sketchfab so that I can share it with the world.
I realized something after I recorded that last part that it might sound like I'm being paid by Sketchfab to upload something. That's not the case. Sketchfab is kind of the place to put things, kind of like YouTube. You could say that you're going to upload something to YouTube. Sketchfab is the same way. So I'm just going to show you how to do that.
Right. So exporting, I go up to the export menu, go down to export textured mesh, and instead of giving like a PLY or OBJ or anything like that, I do upload to Sketchfab. And make sure you have your API key from your account, and you put it at the very top there where I have it all blurred out. Give it a name. Mine's going to be awesome with a cut, you know, a whole bunch of exclamation marks. And instead of using the default thing that that 3D Flow puts in there, I'm going to make it more me by being proud of my state and proud of the place I did this.
Now Zephyr will go ahead and export everything out to Sketchfab, and you can then play with it. You can make sure that everything looks right, and I'll show you that here in a second. But I kind of want to disclose something to you. I spoke with one of the GIS experts here that's responsible for the area that Mount Tipinogos is at, and given the full data set, me running it completely at high detail, it's accurate within a foot or about a third of a meter towards the top. And actually there's some places where he was saying that he could tell that there was a boulder or rock that was 6 inches. He knew that it was 6 inches because they'd gone out and surveyed before. This rock that was 6 inches represented itself on the model from Zephyr as being 6 inches across. And it blew his mind that I was able to fly around a mountain 2 times and get accuracy like that. And he started questioning everything that he did the day that he went out to go do that survey, because there was no need for lasers. There was no need to send one person way the heck off to somewhere else. All they had to do was fly a plane over the mountain. To me, that's very gratifying, and to me, that justifies a lot of the things that I do. And I love proving things right, and I love proving things wrong. And in this case, I proved that I can make a model of a mountain and do it so accurate that the government intergeospatial system is wrong, and that I can do better than that. I think that's pretty freaking cool.
All right, so here we sit 15 minutes into this video, and I can finally show you what it is that I did. This is Mount Tippinogus in northern Utah. There are things that blow my mind about the things you can do with these models on Sketchfab. I'll link to it at the very bottom in the description section. So now it's for me to say goodbye with the final headshot.
I appreciate you giving me your time. That was, what, like 15 minutes? But I was able to take that 15 minutes and take you through the process of going from nothing to having photos, to putting it through photogrammetry software, to actually having a mountain that you can take and show to your grandma on your phone. I think that's incredible that we can do that nowadays. So find something that works for you, find the software that works for you, find the camera that works for you, and go do this stuff. Show the world to the world. And until next time, I'm Scott Nebaker, and this is Red Shirt Media.